Hi, this is Ezekiel Callahan with Raptor Chatter, and today we're going to be looking at the colors of dinosaurs, why they're important, and how they can help us understand extinctions today. 25 years ago, Jurassic Park gave new insights into what dinosaurs would have been like. The Velociraptors gave people the idea of quick, fast, and intelligent dinosaurs, whereas the Brachiosaurus, which is arguably a giraffe titan at the beginning, helped to cement the idea that, yes, this is what dinosaurs were like, yes, this is how dinosaurs behaved, and yes, this is what dinosaurs looked like. But we've come a long way in the last 25 years, and the dinosaurs we know today don't look like the ones on my socks. Melanosome analysis is one of the newest and most exciting techniques developing in paleontology. For years, children and scientists have wondered, what color were dinosaurs? And now we can answer that question. A 2010 study published in Nature showed that using electron microscopes, we can scan across fossils that have soft tissue preservation, so things like feathers and skin, and we can find melanosomes still preserved in the rock. And so now we can tell those children and scientists that, yes, Ichthyornis was black and white like a magpie with a red crest on its head, or that Microraptor had a black iridescence like a crow or a grackle. We can tell what color dinosaurs were, or at least some of them. Life on Earth is very visual, and different species use colors for different things. A raccoon uses its bandit-like mask to help obscure its eyes and reduce glare from the sun. A tiger's stripes act as camouflage. A lizard uses its bright belly to attract a mate, and lemurs use their banded tails to signal to each other. Almost every living thing on Earth uses colors, and these colors come from melanosomes, the parts of cells that absorb and reflect light. Now, the fossilized melanosomes that we do have are just shapes, nothing actually giving color. But we can compare these to the melanosomes in modern species to get an understanding of how the fossilized species may have looked. A 2012 study on Microraptor published in Science looked at its melanosomes, finding that they were greater than a 90% match to the shape and size of melanosomes we find in modern-day birds with iridescence, such as crows or grackles. Another article in the 2013 Journal of Analytical Atomic Spectrometry looked at Archaeopteryx and found that it had dark wingtips. This is an adaptation we see in modern birds as it helps to strengthen the feather for flight. And so these modern analogs we have help to reinforce what we are seeing in the fossil record. Now, color is great to have. We can tell that small theropod dinosaurs like Microraptor had signaling colors or Ichthyornis had signaling colors. But we can tell even more from this. We can tell about environments from this. In 2016, a particularly well-preserved specimen as a Tacosaurus was described in Current Biology. This specimen was unique because it was the first time scientists were able to find melanosomes coming from the skin rather than feathers of a dinosaur. The studies found that Tacosaurus was darkly countershaded, with a light belly being contrasted by its dark sides and back. The same study looked at light diffusion in different environments and found that this kind of countershading works best if it's in a heavily wooded environment. Tacosaurus was an unassuming and small herbivore who eventually found great success, as it or its relatives and their descendants would eventually evolve into the mighty ceratopsians, such as the iconic Triceratops. Likewise, Borealraptor was described with countershading in August 2017 in Current Biology. The paper showed its contrast to modern-day species that are similarly sized, like rhinoceros or elephants. And so Borealraptor was heavily armored with long spines and spikes, but it was afraid. Because of this, despite not finding any carnivores from the site Borealraptor was discovered in, it's become safe to say that there was something that could pose a threat to adult armored dinosaurs. And so from color, we're able to get inferences about environments, predator-prey relationships, but we can also make inferences about breeding. Ichthyornis, which I mentioned earlier, is having a red crest, likely used it as a display structure, as these creatures are quite literally birds before birds. Behaviorally very visual is seen with Microraptor's iridescence and Ichthyornis' crest, and their ability to fly. However, feathers didn't evolve for flight. The first feathers from North America were described in 2012 in a paper published in Science, and these feathers came from an Ornithomimus. So if you remember Jurassic Park, the ones that are flocking this way, it would be something similar to those, but feathered. Now these specimens were important because it had specimens that were both juveniles and adult individuals. And so from this, we're able to see the growth of feathers, with the juveniles having the unofficial term dino fuzz coverings, and the adults having long flight-type feathers. And while both would be too heavy to fly if they had those feathers, it is important to realize that just like a peacock chick doesn't hatch with a long tail, It seems like the feathers didn't grow long for the same reason, meaning that they were probably for display in adult individuals. And so the feathers evolved not for flight, but to look nice, to look pretty. Even the colors that we're finding on our first feathered dinosaur, Cynoceropteryx, have given us tremendous insight. In October 26, 2017, a paper was published in Nature which showed that it had a bandit-like mask across its eyes, much like a raccoon, coatimundi, or some of the lemurs. However, also like some of these species, it had a long banded tail. And so in modern species, this is used for signaling between species, as a 2009 article in the Journal of Comparative Psychology shows in a study of ring-tailed lemurs. And so it seems as though Cynoceropteryx would be at least semi-gregarious and using its tail to signal to others in its species. With this in mind, David Hone, in his April 2017 speech to the Royal Institution, mentions that it's important we don't overanalyze every fossil. So perhaps Cynoceropteryx wasn't gregarious. However, a study of Borealraptor, a related cerulosaur, looked at its tail and found that it was very flexible at the base, but had strong ligaments across the rest of it, so it could be held up for long periods of time. And this adaptation would have needed some purpose, and communication would have been a very good purpose for this kind of adaptation. And we can apply all of this as a species-by-species view of extinction. We can pick out reasons that some species may have gone extinct based on the behaviors we find them having in the fossil record. And so things like Ornithomimus needing to maintain their feathers in order to continue breeding, we can apply that to seabirds and our need to make sure we clean up oil spills and protect our oceans. We can look at things like Cynoceropteryx with its bandit mask and tail, its lighter colors leading to lighter countershading for open environments, and recognize the need to protect those sorts of environments for things like lemurs or red pandas. We can look at species like Inchiornis and Microraptor and their need for open spaces to show off their plumage, but also trees to fly and hunt among, and apply that to modern day species like bowerbirds or birds of paradise. We can apply the knowledge that we've gained based on colors of extinct species and translate that immediately over to living species and how to protect them so that they do not fall the same way. So we might be able to stop species by species extinction based on the fossil record. But we may not have time to stop species by species extinction because we may already be entering another mass extinction. A 2013 paper published by the Paleontological Society mentions that we see differences in the five largest mass extinctions in history, but that we don't know why those differences exist, just that they're there. The largest extinction in history at the end of the Permian is still having causes added to it, and for places we thought we had already researched. A 2011 study by the Geological Society of America looked at evidence in the Sverdrup Basin, a place which had already been researched in the 1900s. Now, this study showed that CO2 and mercury levels in the water pressured the environment before a massive surge in global warming caused by massive volcanic eruptions, which were burning coal beneath them, led to the death of 90% of species on Earth. Another paper by the Paleontological Society in 2008 looks at the press-pulse mechanics of extinction. A pressure is put on a planet. So something like lowering water levels with the dinosaurs, or the CO2 and mercury for the Permian. And then a pulse strikes, like a meteor, like massive volcanic eruptions, and wipes out life. We've already put a lot of pressure on this planet, and we don't know what our pulse will be or what it will do. How many species would a meteor strike kill? How many species would Yellowstone's eruption kill? How many species would a nuclear war, even just a small nuclear war, kill? We may not be able to save every species, but we might be able to save some of them. Hello everyone, thank you for watching. This is a speech that I might actually be performing for competition, which is part of the reason it gets so dark there at the end, is judges love big impacts of everything dying and drama and all of that, so it's a good idea to have it there. And so some of the logical jumps that are there haven't been completely confirmed and have just been theorized, but they all do stand up to logical reason. I would also like to thank my editor and all the researchers for helping me make this possible, as without the research or the editing, the fantastic editing I have, I would not have been able to complete this video. I also want to mention that there is a new paper that came out actually today as I am recording this, which actually mentions a new species that was found with even more bright plumage, and so that's something that I will link down below so that you can look at that, as it is even more relevant than some of the stuff that I had already mentioned. Thank you again for watching. Leave a comment if you think I forgot anything, and remember to follow my Twitter if you want updates on when videos are coming out. And be safe, take care, save the planet.